hope you all are caught up in the spirit of the Sabbath this morning. Amen. Where we've come here to worship God in truth and in spirit. It's so vital to realize that fact, that it is our spirit, though we are in the flesh, that makes such a wonderful difference as we are filled with the power of God in our lives. And so may the Lord bless us as we fellowship together. And we just like to welcome all our visitors this morning. Amen. We just heard the music from the bottom and we're wondering who is presenting us with this outstanding music as an introduction this morning. And I think it's important. Can you just stand before the church, you know, to take cognizance of your presence as visitors to our church and also making such an impactful effect with them. Music. We thank you very much. I think they deserve our honor. We thank you very much for such a wonderful rendition this morning. And we would like to also think of our visitors this morning. We know we always have visitors. Praise the Lord for that. And it's so amazing how God has led people to our church. Attest to the fact that it has been such a wonderful outreach to meet and see different people as they come to church this morning. And we pray that by God's grace and God's blessing, those people that have come here under different names, coming from different churches, that they'll find this place as a home of homes amongst the fellow Christians. So let us be one, brethren, and let us all be one as we worship God without any influence from the power of Satan in our midst this morning. We just got a few announcements to make this morning. And I will just... I just got a few announcements to make this morning. The first one is that we will be having a gym night next door. As you know, that next door is also, we're thankful for the services that they have, and also that it's whenever we have extraordinary events, we always have the privilege of using the building next door. Details will be provided, but just to let you know that there will be a gym night, and next week they'll give us follow-up details. There's bills here that have been paid by the church, and in fact, it's telling us that if Virgin warns 14 days and on the... nine digits, there is actually something that is wrong with them. Please resubmit with 14 days that same bill. Now, it has absolutely no name. So it's something that you yourself who has submitted this bill should know who you are. If you can see Sister Petsisai, she'll give you all the details that are necessary. So please bear that in mind, somebody whose rent and the bills were paid for just this week, I presume. Further announcements. We will be starting our fast on Sundown Friday, April the 19th. And it's a reminder to all of us, until Saturday, April the 20th, we will be having a prayer meeting downstairs after Sabbath on April the 20th. Also, our next monthly meeting will be on May the 4th this year. And women's ministry, Thursday and Friday, Zoom only at 7:30 to 8:30 p.m. This will occur on Saturday, May the 11th, 2024. Women will hold all Sabbath programs from the morning to evening, including a potluck as well. Please bear that in mind, and also together with a fundraising music concert to raise money for our department. So we solicit your special help in attending and also helping out with the department for raising funds as well. Bear that in mind, especially when it will take place, as I say, May the 11th, on this coming month, as it were. I think basically to a large extent, those are the major announcements, and not forgetting our prayer meeting, which also is held online on Zoom, and let us meet together once again. And also I would like to mention that we would also like to meet with the superintendents and all the Sabbath school teachers immediately after divine service downstairs. It's very, very important, and we require or need your presence to be there. Thank you very much. God bless you as we now worship the Lord in truth and in spirit.
Good morning, everyone. I feel very special right now. You saw me talking to a young lady over here, and you've heard me say that when I came to this church, there were lots of other people here, and we used to sing together in different languages. Her family was one of them that sang in another language while we sang the English. So I'm so glad to see you today. You and your family, all your children. Welcome whenever you come to this part of the earth again. And they are going to, they were a musical family, and her children are playing, so they're going to be accompanying us. And we'd love to show them that we could still sing here. So we are going to begin with hymn number 565. It will remind us about the events that happened this week with the sun. For the beauty of the earth. I liked that black and silver that we saw in the sky. For the beauty of the earth.
This our hymn of grill of
that we have warmed up our voices. Any children around? Could I see your hands, please? All the kids. Could you stand so I could see you? I have a song for you, and you're going to sing before the adults sing. And it says, Jesus loves me, this I know. That's what our Sabbath school lesson with the children was. Jesus loved us, all of us, big and small. So we're going to have the words up here, and you are going to sing. I want to hear you, okay? Let's go.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Now the adults will help us. Okay, let's go.
Jesus loves me, he who died, heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash away my sin. Let this little child come in.
Last hymn for this session is number 202. 202.
Children of God, look up with reason. rejoicing, shout and sing his praise. Blessed are they who wait in a watching, look for the coming days. Tell him the King of glory wants the Lamb for sinners slain. Tell the wondrous story, Jesus comes to reign. Amen.
Let us stand for a call to worship. I read the white one and you will follow with the next one. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, made himself nothing. Therefore, my dear friends, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. Children of God, without fault, amen. Let us bow down our heads to pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the privilege to come before your presence today. We have come to learn from you the ways that will help us to be like you. We invite your Holy Spirit, Lord, that you may come and fill this place this moment, that the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart may be acceptable before thee, O Lord our God, in Jesus' name, amen. Remain standing.
Our opening hymn is number 289. And we will sing this not as fast as we were singing, because the Savior is waiting for all of us to be ready to receive him. You let him come.
At this time, we'll ask the children to come forward as we listen to the children's story by our dear brother, Kevon.
I'm not brother. I'm Sister Sharon. I'm just filling in this morning. And you know, that's how God's people can be. When someone is absent, we can fill in, right? Because it's his work. Good morning, everyone. Morning, boys and girls. Happy to see new faces. How was your week this week? How was school? School was good, right? Anybody had an exciting time this week? That's cool, yes? You want to share? She doesn't want to share. Did you want to share something exciting?
We had more time playing outside.
I like that. They had more time playing outside. It was exciting for me because on Monday, did you guys get to see the eclipse? Wasn't that like, wow? Did you put your protective glasses on? Did you have, no? Yeah, okay.
Okay, is this better? Okay, good. Did you want to, okay.
I saw the eclipse on my mom's laptop.
All right, that's a good way to look at it. It was amazing to see God's glory, right? Just beam that day. But I want to ask a question this morning. What's your favorite story in the Bible?
Jesus being crucified.
Yes, yes. Anybody else? What's your favorite story?
Little David.
Very nice. Anybody else? What's your favorite story when you read the Bible? You're like, wow.
Mrs. Samuel.
Yes, just about every story you go, wow. You know, one of my favorite story is when the disciples was on the boat and a storm suddenly came up and they were so afraid. Jesus was on the boat, right? You remember? Yes, he was. And it was dark, and the waters were rough, and they began to do what? Anybody remember what the disciples began to do on the boat?
Scream.
I'm sure they did that. I know I would.
They were praying to their, like, fake gods.
That's right.
They woke Jesus up.
They woke Jesus up. But before that, they started to throw all their belongings just so that the boat would get lighter. But the storm got even more fierce. And then they forgot that Jesus was on the boat. That is something we don't ever want to do, to forget that Jesus is always with us, right? And then a lightning flashed, and then they saw Jesus. What was he doing in the boat? Anybody remember?
Sleeping.
Was he sleeping because he was he's snoring? Was he sleeping because he was tired? Okay, so no. Who said no?
Because he wanted the disciples to wake him up, so he knows that they believe in him.
Yes.
Maybe he wanted to test the disciples to see how big their faith was.
That's right. That's right. But you know, to me, when I read that story, thank you, it says that he was just trusting in his Father's love and care. So it didn't matter what was happening around him. He was at peace. He was just at rest. That made me remember a story, something that happened in 2004. Around 7:58 that morning, I was listening on my radio, and I was listening to something that I've never heard happen before. It happened in 2004. And it happened in a country in Asia called Sri Lanka. That day, I would never forget, because I remember the gentleman that was talking has just been through that experience just a few days before. And an earthquake had struck the shores of Sri Lanka, beautiful shores. On top of that, a tsunami, everything was happening the same time. Do you know what is a tsunami? Anybody know what that is? Yes, probably as tall as this building, and they can get even taller. And that morning, I was listening as the missionary was telling that he had built an orphanage. Do you know what's an orphanage? Okay.
Where homeless people live.
For children who had no mommies and daddies, and he would take care of them, and they would live right in this huge home right on the shores. And that morning he woke up, and as he looked out, he saw, as his wife described to him first, she says, the oceans are coming in. Well, he thought it was just some waves, and she said, no, with fear in her voice, he got up, and as he looked through the window, the kids were already out on the shore. Because every morning they would go out for their play, and the staff would be with them. And he said, as he looked, he saw this huge wave coming with such a speed that he had no time to warn the kids or to take anything. He just shoot right downstairs onto that beach. Guess what he did? Anybody know? What would you do at that moment when you see a huge tidal wave coming at such a speed towards you? What would be the first thing to do?
He prayed.
He did. He quoted Isaiah 59. Verse 19, and you know what it said? It says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will lift up a standard against him. And you know what he did? He commanded that water to stood still. It was just a few seconds away from the children. And he can see the hand holding that water back. And as he was standing with the children, he said to them, I want all of you to head to the boathouse, and I want no one to even look at that wave. So once he got the staff to get that boat, it only fit about 12 to 15 in that boat. It wasn't a very big boat. All the children obeyed, and they went into that boat as the water stood. And as they got into the boat, he said, I want everybody to put their heads down and keep their heads between their legs. Do not ever look up, including the staff, because everybody was so fearful. Here is this huge water just standing there. And he knew it was God who kept that water. And as the children got into the boat, the next prayer was, Lord, save these children and take that boat where it would be safe. Do you know where the Lord took the boat? On top of the water. On top of that huge wave. And I'm sitting there with tears and I'm going, wow. And everybody listened. Nobody was screaming. Nobody became anxious because they were not looking at the storm. They were not looking at the wave. And before you know it, the boat was up onto the water. And that water brought that boat down as it came down, and everybody was saved. Not one person was lost. Because why?
They believed in God.
Yes, they believed that he was there to save them. And they did not look
That's why they followed him, his rules.
Amen. So whenever we face a storm, don't look at the storm. Don't look at how big the situation is. Keep our eyes on Jesus. Would someone like to close in prayer? It's okay. No, nobody wants to pray yet? Okay, I'll pray. Let's close our eyes. We thank you, Lord, this morning for how you care and you protect each one of us. Thank you, Lord, that even when the storms or anything in our lives may come, you are right there, never to forget that. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much.
Trusting God and putting God first in every aspect of life makes all the difference when we face difficult times. Ed Nilsson and Rose worked with a small refrigerated truck delivering frozen goods to supermarkets in Manaus, Brazil. But after they were robbed 3 times, they lost nearly everything they owned, accumulating a significant amount of debt. Not knowing what to do, they got down on their knees. After putting their difficult situation in God's hands, they felt they should start a new business with the money they still had on hand. The problem was that all they had was $5. What can you do with this amount of money? As they were trying to put God first in all, they trusted that He could turn that small value into something great. The couple was then impressed to buy ingredients and to bake 16 loaves of whole grain bread. They quickly sold all the loaves to neighbors and friends and were moved by the recognition of God's mighty hand in their new business. After returning the tithe and promise offerings, they invested the net profit to buy more ingredients and make more bread. And so, in such a simple way, they started what today has become a company with 15 employees that produces 45,000 loaves of bread a month. Here is how they plan to honor God with their business. 1. They help others start their business with whatever they have. 2. They promote a healthy lifestyle in town. 3. They are strongly committed to returning their tithes, along with a promise offering equivalent to 15% of all the company's profits. And God, by His mighty hand, is adding all that we need day by day, say Edda Nilsson and Rose. As we return our tithe and promise offering, may we put our desires last and God first.
May the deacons please come up for the tithe and offering. Today's offering is going to the Hope Channel. Thank you. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for bringing us all here to church today. We thank you for being our God and keeping us safe. We pray that you bless this offering and that it will be used to help those in need of your love, dear Lord. We pray that you will help this money so that it will help more people know of you and your sacrifice for us, dear Lord. We pray that you provide for all of our needs, whatever they may be it financial needs, physical needs, spiritual needs, dear Lord. We pray that you continue to provide for us and that you bless us, dear Lord. We pray that you help us today to learn more of you and that when we leave here, your blessings won't stop flowing over us, dear Lord. We pray that you continue to keep us safe, and we thank you, for we know that you've answered our prayers. For in your name we pray, amen.
Hear our prayer, Lord, pray. Take our hearts and minds far away from the press of the world all around to your throne where grace does abound. May our transformed by your love. May our souls be refreshed from above. At this moment, let people everywhere join us now as we come to you in a prayer.
Let us pray. Our most gracious and everlasting Father in heaven, we have come before your presence to say thank you to you because we acknowledge that you are the King of Kings and you are the Lord of Lords. We thank you because from everlasting to everlasting, you remained the same and you changed not. We thank you for sparing our lives. We are not better than the dead, and we've not done anything specially to merit your grace and your favor. We thank you because you are our creator, you are our maker, you are our shelter, and you are our defender, and you are still the Ancient of Days. And it is with hearts filled with gratitude that we have come to say, may all glory, all honor, and adoration be ascribed unto your holy name. Our Father and our God, we pray for forgiveness of sins. We pray that you cleanse us of all our unrighteousness and make us pure and whole. We thank you for even the signs that you have shown us within this passing week that this is still our Father's word, that you are in total control of the heaven and the earth, and you've created them, and the earth is just your footstool. Our dear Lord and our God, we are happy that you made us to see those signs that we can reflect and trust more in thee, knowing fully well that whatever comes our way, that you are still in charge. We want to thank you for sparing our lives. We want to thank you for protecting us and providing for us. You've given us relative peace to worship you. There are people in so many places on this surface earth that they can't gather to worship you, but you've made it possible for us to gather, and we pray that you accept our worship, accept our praises and offering. Let it be like a sweet smelling savour before thee. Let our worship for this day be acceptable unto thee, our dear Lord and our God, as this time we pray that you meet us at the very point of our need. So many of us have come in here sick. We pray that we will not depart from your presence the same way. So many of us have come with one pain or the other, with different life challenges that we are hoping that you help us take care of them. We have those who are in sick beds, those who are in their hospitals beds, those who are shut in, who can't come in to worship you. We pray that as you bless us with the blessings of the Sabbath, that you extend the same blessing unto them. We pray, dear Lord, that you keep us standing by your grace. Help us never let go of our hands, because we can do nothing without thee. Help us, dear Lord, that at the end of our worship today, we will be happy that we have worshipped in your presence. As we go into this divine service, we present your son, Ike, who will be breaking the bread of life. Hide him behind the cross. Help him to speak through you, that we may see you reflecting. We want to thank you that at the end of this day, we'll be happy that we have been in your presence. Let it be our response be like that of David, who would say, I was happy when they say, let us go into the house of the Lord. We know that in your presence that there is fullness of joy. In the midst of the turmoil in this earth, give us that peace which passeth all understanding. And we trust thee, because you have told us in the book of Hebrew that we should approach your throne with confidence. It is with that confidence that we have come to your throne of mercy to ask for help, because we know that the righteousness of Christ covers us. Thank you, dear Lord, because you will do even much more than we can ever ask or imagine. For we have prayed with thanksgiving in Jesus' name.
Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline thy ear to us and grant us thy peace. Happy Sabbath, Church.
Happy
Sabbath. So good to be in the house of the Lord once more. I trust that you all have a wonderful and blessed week. Today I'll be doing the scripture reading, and it will be taken from St. Matthew 22, reaching from verse 36 to 40. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second one is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated.
Happy Sabbath, Church. While growing up, my father used to love hymn number 327, and the family made a quartet with it, and we love singing it. And I want to pass it on also to my daughter. And the song said, I'd rather have Jesus than anything. It doesn't matter what goes around us. It doesn't matter what happens around us. It doesn't matter how people treat you. But we've chosen to love Jesus and to have him above everything. Amen. Yeah. Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand
than to be the king of a vast land. I'll be held in sin, grass wet. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to
yes, he is fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He is sweeter than honey from out the core.
He is all that my hungering heart with need. I'd rather
to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin, rest well.
I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Our time is already fast spent, and I wish I could just let us go. Yeah, but we'll see what we can do so that we can hear the word of God before we go home, right? Amen. And today we want to talk about loving others. Loving your neighbors as yourself. Before we go into the message of today, I also want to welcome our brother and the family again for coming to be with us today. I want to tell you that God is happy that you're here today. I don't know if there is any other friend that is here today that is just coming for the first time. Wherever you are, Brother Emmanuel. Brother Emmanuel, we're happy to have you. God bless you. You're welcome, brother. Any other person? I see Sister Sharon. I just want to assure us that we are in our Father's house, right? So let's be comfortable and not be in a hurry to leave our Father's house, because we must hear his word as he speaks to us today. We're going to pray, and I'm also going to invite my daughter to come with me as we make this prayer to God. Yes, Janelle. I'm going to pray, and then Janelle is going to sing her own prayer in a song. I want all of us to bow down our heads. And then when I say amen, we can open our eyes, and then Janelle will sing her prayer in a song. But I want you to pray as your heads are bowed, that God will speak to us. God will speak to our individual hearts, that we will be able to hear his word. Because I'm also concerned because of my accent. It could be an obstacle, but if the Lord speaks to your heart, he will speak to you clearly in the voice that you will understand. Our Heavenly Lord in heaven, our Father, the hour has come that you have set aside to speak to your people. I do not have any words of mine. Hide me behind the cross and let thy words come out of my mouth, that the people may hear and be edified. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that is already here. Fill our heart, O Lord, and give us the message of the hour, that we may go home and be a blessing to our families and to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Your holy word, take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith.
That we may hear this moment, the words of life, the words that you have prepared for us today. You know, as we near the end of time, as we near the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus, the devil is not sleeping. So he is throwing things at us, you know, to distract us. He's throwing things at us so that we can lose our focus on Christ Jesus and his coming. And he is bringing discord amongst brethren so that we can fight each other. And then we will lose the sight of Jesus coming. And that will be unspeakable damage to the body of Christ. If we have not been a part of this situation, people, brothers fighting brothers, wars, rumors of wars, we have heard. It is all over the news. Rumors of wars, brothers are fighting brothers. Inflations everywhere, starvation, hatred. This could be disheartening, right? But are we marveled that these things are happening? Should we marvel that we are having this court, this fight amongst ourselves, amongst people, countries fighting against each other? Are we marveled? Are we surprised? We shouldn't be. Why? Because the word of God has said it long time ago. Jesus said it when he was here on earth. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 3, his disciples came to him privately and said, tell us when all these things will happen. When will the end be? When you read Matthew chapter 24 from verse 1 down, Jesus told them what was going to happen. A lot of things, including wars and rumors of wars, brothers fighting brothers and all that. And then Paul, when he was writing to Timothy, in 2 Timothy chapter 3, from verse 1 to 5, God revealed more of the things that are going to happen in our time in these last days through Paul writing to Timothy. And there Paul said, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such turn away. Now, can someone tell me which of these in this list that we are not experiencing today? Anyone? Is there anything in this list that we've just mentioned that we are not experiencing today? Men are lovers of themselves. Men are brutal. You see men slaughtering other men with a knife, like as if they are slaughtering a cow. What does it mean to us? What does these things mean to us? It means that we are in the last days. We are in the last days because all that has been said in the scripture is coming to pass. The question is, knowing and seeing that we are in the last days, what manner of persons ought we to be? What manner of persons should we be as we see all these things come to pass, as we say it in our country, before our very before? Before our eyes, we see these things happening. What manner of persons should we be? And in the context of the message of today, from where we took our Bible reading, from Matthew chapter 22, 36 to 40, Jesus said to them, when somebody came and said, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus said in 37, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor, love others as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Meaning that in these last days, if there is nothing that we can do, we must love God and we must love others. Loving others is the title of our message today. Loving others. In these last days, we must love others.
Unfortunately, many of us do not love others, including me, who is the chief of all sinners. We do not love others, and yet we claim that we love God. And in 1 John chapter 4, verse 20, he says, whoever claims to love God yet does what? Hates a brother or a sister is what? We are liars. We are, and I don't want to say we all, because there might be an exception amongst us. But many of us are liars, because we claim that we love God, but we may not hate, like we may put it, it may not that we hate him or her, we don't like him. We don't like him. Or we may not even use the word like, we may say, I don't really like to associate with them. And as the text continues, it says, for whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. It is as true and as simple as it is. You say you love God you've not seen, and you cannot love the brother and sister that you see. And he has given us this command. Anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. He said it's a must. In these last days, we must love our brothers and our sisters. Because we can say we all love God. Okay, good. But our brothers and sisters? Question mark. Because to love our brothers and sisters, in the context of the message of today, we must also recognize and respect and honor individuals' rights. It doesn't matter their gender, their color, their nationality, their personality. You must, as you pronounce, as you proclaim that you love others, you have to honor, recognize, and respect their individual rights, because it is very key to God and to humanity. When you talk about human rights, God has endowed us, we humans have been endowed with rights and liberties by virtue of our birth and nationality. These rights include civil and political rights, such as right to life, liberty, privacy, economic and social and cultural rights, such as right to social security, health, and adequate housing. We also have rights of freedom of religion, speech, education, and assembly. All these rights are in place to protect, preserve, and ensure that every individual can live a life of dignity and worthy of a human being. You know, in Proverbs chapter 31, verse 8 and 9, the Bible says, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and needy. So the Bible recognizes that we have rights as human beings. And if you say you love me, you have to respect my rights. It is not for you to judge what I should do. I have a right to life. I have a right to live anyhow, any way I want to live, because God has given us choice. And we have learned in this church that the choice is an act of love. The choice is an act of love. Therefore, we must respect and honor people's rights. As a matter of fact, anyone that violates other people's rights or supports those who violate other people's rights, the Word of God says they are in danger of God's judgment. Speak, O Lord, that the people may hear. Of course, we're not talking about those rights that are contrary to the law of God, to the Word of God. We're not talking about those rights that contradict God's Word. No. And Ellen White also said something about rights of human beings. In the Gospel Worker paragraph 123.1, Ellen White said, "The law demands our acknowledgement of the rights of every man. Men's social rights and their rights as Christians are to be taken into consideration. All are to be treated with refinement and delicacy as sons and daughters of God." That's what Ellen White says, recognizing that we as humans have rights. Now let's come back. I believe we have been able to clearly see that every human being has rights, and those rights need to be respected and acknowledged. But the message of today is saying to you as an individual that you must be willing, as a Christian, you must be willing to give up your right when it is becoming an obstacle to the Word of God or to the salvation of others. As much as it is right for no one to trample upon our rights, you who has claimed to be a Christian, you must be willing to give up that right. That's right you stand on and say, "It is my right. It's my right. You can't do anything about it." As a Christian, you must be willing to give it up. But how? For what reason, you may ask? Why should I give up my right? Even when heaven has recognized that I have a right, why should I give up my right? Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 12. I have just done 15 minutes. Beautiful. I have it up, but I still want you to open your Bibles so that it won't be as if we didn't come to church with our Bibles. And if possible, you can have your Bible open on 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 9, 10. We're going to look at those places. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 12. It says here from my Bible, New King James Version, "If others are partakers of these rights over you, are we not even more?" Paul is saying here, if others have this right of support, when you read the New International Version, if they have this right of support from you, shouldn't we have it all more? I can put it up now. But we did not use this right. On the contrary, we put up with anything rather than do what? Hinder the gospel of Christ. That is one reason why you should not stand on that right as a Christian. Because you may be hindering the gospel of Christ. You know, Paul does walk in the night and he goes preaching in the day. By every authority, Paul is entitled to be paid from the collections that are made in the churches that he established. Like we do pay the pastors today from the church, and other church workers are paid from the tithe and offerings that we give. Paul has a right. He said, if others have this right, we have it. Or we should have it more. But because I do not want to hinder the gospel of Christ, I have decided to walk in the night and do my missionary work and preach, and it will not stop him. I don't know the rights that we are dragging right now in our homes, in our workplaces. That could be hindering the gospel of Christ to someone there. I don't know whatever it is that could be hindering the gospel of Christ. If you listen to what is going on in the world today, a lot of people are saying, we have these prosperity pastors preaching and they are living big. A lot of people, not Adventists, they already know that these people are living big on the collection of people. And they keep telling you, God will bless you, but I have a lot of pastors in my country, a couple of them, that have private jets and all that. But their members are barely feeding, just barely able to get a meal. But they are living big. They are living big. People are already saying that those people are not doing the work of God. The Bible also said it. They are working for their bellies. They are hindering the gospel of Christ. And you, as a Christian, as an Adventist, how are you hindering the gospel of Christ? You know, anything we do, though it is within our rights, though we may be doing it genuinely, though we may be doing it without anything in mind, anything that we do that can make others think twice about Christianity, anything that we do that will make people say, if this is the way God's followers behave or do, I don't want to be part of it. Though it may be your right, you and I are hindering the gospel of Christ to those people. You know, and sometimes we may think that it is foolishness to give up our right. Some may think it is you're being coward for giving up your right. Why should I do that? Okay, let me remind you. Maybe you are saying the men of God in the Bible who gave up their rights, you are saying they are foolish too. People like Moses who said, I'd rather suffer with the children of Israel and have all this right and live big in Egypt. Maybe Abraham that said, Lot, just choose. For the peace of others, we must give up our right. Paul is one of them. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, in New King James Version, the Bible says, but beware lest somehow this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to those who are weak. And I love the way it is in New International Version. It says there, be careful, however, that the exercise of your rights does not become what? A stumbling block to the weak. Be careful as you exercise those rights, as you stand on those rights and said you are immovable, that they will not become a stumbling block to the weak. Though in the context of 1 Corinthians chapter 8, Paul was talking about meat offered to idols. And Paul said, look, with the knowledge of God I have, I don't believe that these idols have anything, has any power, because there is only but one God. If you read 1 Corinthians chapter 8, Dan, that's what that place says. It said, there is only but one God who created all things. All these idols are stones and woods that people carved and made idols. But he also recognized that in Corinth, where he has preached to these people, they were all pagan worshippers. And so they believe in all this. And Paul is saying, if I now, do I have this knowledge that these things are nothing, if I go and eat this meat, this new convert will say, what? What is he doing? Why is he eating those meats? That will wound the heart, this conscience of this weak person or this new convert. Paul says, I will not exercise this right to eat this meat, though I know it is no problem for me, but because of this brother, I will not eat this meat. That is loving, brothers and sisters. That's what it's all about. In the lesson this morning, we were talking about love, practical love, and I love what we shared in our class. Practical love. How do you show that you love a brother or a sister when you cannot give up some things because you love them? Paul was more concerned about the conscience of others. He was so much concerned because he loved them. And that's why in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 and 4, because of our time, I'll just go to there. Let nothing be done through what? Through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but for the what? For the interest of others, loving others. Loving others. Paul is urging us, those of you that are strong in faith, that you should be willing when it is necessary. It is not saying that give up your rights. Give up all your rights. Give it up. You don't have any right. No. There are times that it is necessary for you to give up your right, that right. It says, Paul is saying, you that is strong in faith, when it is necessary, give up that right. Those rights that you exercise so openly that are capable of harming the faith and obedience of those who are less in faith. Give them up. And let none hear you. Let none say, I don't care. Because that's what we usually say. I don't care. As long as I'm doing the right thing, I don't care. As long, I don't care what they say, what they do. I am doing the right thing. I must do it. Don't say I don't care. You know, Matthew chapter 18, verse 6 and 7, it says, if anyone, before you say I don't care, before we say we don't care, it says, if anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it will be what? Better for them to have a large milestone hung around their neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of the things that cause people to stumble. Such things must come, but woe to the person through whom they come. So before you say, I don't care, I am doing the right thing, no. Be careful, because it could be harming somebody's faith, somebody that is close by. Be careful. Also in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10 to 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 9, 10 to 13 actually, says, for if someone with a weak conscience sees you with all your knowledge eating in an idol's temple, wouldn't that person be emboldened to eat what is sacrificed to idols? So, this weak brother or sister for whom Christ died is destroyed by your knowledge. When you sin against them in this way and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if what I eat causes my brother or sister to fall into sin, I will never eat meat again, so that I will not cause them to fall. Talking about people, brothers, loving others. If what I do will cause them to sin, I will not do it again. The key word there is emboldened. Emboldened is to give confidence, to give courage. A brother or sister who is struggling with maybe secular music or something or dance, the person dances all the time and tweak and all that, and the person is struggling with this and at the verge of deciding whether to come out of it or not, or in dressing, trying to come out of it, and then he sees you or she sees you dress up, you know, to kill, or you dance and tweet, or you listen to music and blast, and the person is saying, oh, this brother or sister, and they always participate in the church, they are preachers, they are teachers. Oh, if they are doing this, then it is all right. You embolden person to go into sin, to continue in that, and from that, you know, it takes one little thing, and then the other, and then the other, and the person become wide. So when you do those things, though they are what is you're entitled, it's your right, you're at liberty to do it, you have the freedom to do it. When you do those things so openly, and other people are emboldened to continue in their sin, in their, you know, their bad lifestyle. It says, when you are doing that, you are sinning against those brothers or sisters. And when you do that, you're also sinning against God. Again, I want to remind us that it is very apparent that we must honor people's rights, because we have seen in the case of Jezebel and Ahab, King Ahab, when they by force violated Naboth's right by taking the vineyard that belongs to him, God was not happy with them. So when we violate other people's rights, God is not happy with us. But as Christians, we must give up our right. And you know why we are struggling, or why we may struggle with this message? Why we will not want to give up our right? It's because we are not yet dead in self or to self. We can struggle with it because we are not dead to self. We are not what Paul said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That is why we are not living the life. We are still living in flesh. And so we can argue and struggle with these things. I cannot. And you know, marriages are suffering because spouses are standing on their right and said, it's my right. Marriages are falling apart. It's my right. Children's mental health is being affected. And they're saying, it's my right. It's my right. And we're having divorces, separations. And they're saying, it's my right. It's my right. Countries said, it's my right. Of course, we know that one of the issues with Russia and Ukraine. Ukraine, right? One of the problem is, it's my right. These people say, I have the right to be part of this. These people said, you are part of us, it's our right. And then millions are being killed every day. It's my right. It's my right. Friends are parting. Families are having issues. It's my right. I can't give up my right. But here, Galatians says, if we give up our right, it will only take those who are crucified in Christ to give up their right, because they now live, Christ now lives in them. Who is the ultimate life right surrender? Christ surrendered what? His position, his right in heaven. He surrendered his position, his right. When you read Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 7, to 8, Philippians, it says, Paul is now saying, in your relationship with one another, he says, you should do what? Have this same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even the death of Christ on the cross. So, the one that we are waiting for is coming. He gave up his right, so that you and me can be saved. What is it? Why can't we also, for the love of others, give up some certain things that are becoming an issue in our homes, in the church? We need to give up our right. And I'm going to close with this quote from Ellen White. And it's going to be a tough one, really. But that's what Ellen White, the spirit of prophecy, said. And if the spirit of prophecy has said that, I believe it. It says, if a Christian is abused, do what? take it patiently. If defrauded, he should do what? He should not appeal to cause of justice. Rather, let him or her suffer loss and wrong. That's hard, right? Because none of us want to take loss. None of us want to suffer loss. We want to go to the court of law or code of conduct so that we can get our justice. But she's saying, do not go. See, God will deal with the unworthy church member or whoever who defrauds his brother or the cause of God. The Christian need not contend for his rights. Christians, we need not to contend for our rights. Why? Say, God will deal with them, whoever that violates these rights. Because she quoted Romans chapter 12, verse 19, vengeance is mine, I will repay, said the Lord. An account is kept of all these matters, and for the Lord to declare that he will avenge, he will do what? He will bring every work into judgment. He said we should not. We should not. So, brothers and sisters, as we close, will you make a commitment to God and say, though it is tough, though I cannot stand it, though I have been taken advantage of, but like Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 13, he said, therefore, if what I do, what I eat, will cause a brother or a sister to sin, he said, I will not. Will you make a commitment and say, I will, by God's grace, give up anything, any right, though they are mine, that will make a brother to sin or that will become a stumbling block? It is a choice that you have to make. And I pray that God will help us to make the right choice. Amen.
After such admonition, we will rise and sing hymn number 286, Wonderful Words of Life.
Wonderful words of life, words of life.
as we bow down our heads, I want to call for anyone who is willing to make a commitment to God. We know we can't do this by ourselves because it is very key, as we are in these last days, that we are willing to give up any right, anything that will cause a brother to sin. And so I'm going to call that anyone who desires to make this commitment and say, God, help me. I want to give up something, this thing that is making, that could cause someone to sin, that could cause a stumbling block to someone, that could embolden someone to sin. I want to give it up. I want you to join me, the chief of all sinners, as we make this commitment. I want you to get on your knees. If you want to make this commitment, it is not for everyone. It is for those who desire to make a change as we near the second coming of Christ, that we want to change, want to make this commitment to give up something, to give up something. Get on your knees, and I will invite Brother Edda Thompson to pray for us as we make this commitment.
Shall we pray? Our gracious, merciful Father, we humbled ourselves before your throne as we've heard inspiring, challenging words that are so impactful upon each one of us. Heavenly Father, we are living in a sinful world. May the power and ministry of the Holy Spirit help us, Lord, to see an introspective inspection to realize that we can be a stumbling block to somebody. And so we pray, Heavenly Father, for the power and the ministry of the Holy Spirit to embroider, Heavenly Father, our perception, that we may be humbled before your throne of grace this morning, that the power of your word as presented to our hearing may fall on fertile ground this morning, Heavenly Father, that each one of us may realize just how much we need the presence of a saving Savior, well implanted within and every one of us, so that, Lord, we may be living a life that is acceptable in your sight, being there for others, being considerate to others. Heavenly Father, for we realize we are to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, a humble master, a loving master, a caring master, who gave everything in heaven this morning to reach out and touch humanity such that each one of us may be indeed imbued with a power that only comes from heaven above. Bless us, Lord, that we may see ourselves this morning, that your word has fallen on fertile soil, that our minds indeed may indeed be the mind where Christ in the presence of God is within us, that we be able to live a life, a life that reflects Christ in us as a hope of glory. Bless each one of us, Lord, by the power and ministry of the word spoken, that we'll live according to your word. In Jesus' mighty and holy name we pray. Amen. And amen.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
pleasant Sabbath to everyone.